9:30 p.m., May 4th, 1886. Chicago, Illinois, near Haymarket Square.
Good evening, Mayor. How's it going?
You can send the reserves home, Jack. I just spent over an hour at that meeting. Nothing more is going to happen tonight.
I should hope not, Your Honor. 50,000 lousy anarchists out on strike. Two killed yesterday. Another riot at the Reaper Works this afternoon.
Now, Jack, don't look for trouble. Send the extra men home.
Yes, sir. As soon as it breaks up. I just want to make sure they don't go for the freight warehouses.
All right. Use your best judgment. Good night.
Good night, sir.
Holding you back, any inspector?
Fielden just told the crowd to have nothing more to do with the law, to throttle it.
Is the mayor still here?
No, sir, I think he's gone. They're going to break it up in just a few minutes.
I think maybe we'll just make sure of that.
Hey, Marcus! Police! 50, 60! They're coming down Huron Street to Haymarket Square. I see them myself!
The meeting's over anyway, Albert, and it's starting to rain. Please stay.
Gotta go back.
In the name of the people of the state of Illinois, I command this meeting immediately and peaceably to disperse.
No!
Would come to be known as the Haymarket Riot. An anarchist bomb exploded in the ranks of six companies of policemen. Seven policemen died, many were severely wounded. In the panic that followed, hundreds were injured, rioters were shot, and several were killed. Someday, this tragedy would be forever linked to the name of John Peter Altgeld.
Lucy out there?
Not yet.
So, Albert.
So,
how was it in Springfield?
Very moving. Things have changed during the years since the trial. There were hundreds there, Albert. Gompers, Buchanan, Henry Lloyd, General Trumbull. The governor heard them all. Letters, telegrams, petitions by the thousands.
Petitions? For mercy.
Governor Oglesby is a decent man. It was a trial for him, too. There was so much pressure on both sides.
What were the results? Fielden and Schwab got a gift of a lifetime in prison. Poor little Niebuhr got 15 years. Magnanimous Caesar. That still leaves four of us to vindicate American justice.
Albert, there may still be a chance. Plead for clemency. It's not too late,
George. Start that again.
Albert, survival is the first law. They wanted to save you. I'm sure of it. It's better to live and fight.
What about Spies? And Engel, Fisher?
I'm talking about you. What are you trying to prove by dying?
That democracy is a lie. That liberty and justice went down with Lincoln. That the fat capitalists own the country. And the laws and the courts and the newspapers.
I don't want their mercy. I committed no crime. They tried us for murder. Yet they're the ones that are doing the killing. Let the blood be on their filthy hands. Yes, I'm an anarchist. I believe what I believe down in my guts. And when they break my neck at noon tomorrow, the truth will be fixed and unchangeable forever.
Your good governor could have given me back my freedom. That and nothing else.
I understand your convictions, Albert. But I cannot believe what you are doing is right.
It's right for me.
Do I make you feel guilty? When William Lloyd Garrison was put into a Boston prison for his advanced ideas on abolishing slavery, his friend Wendell Phillips came to visit. Phillips said, William, I'm sorry to see you in there. And Garrison said, Wendell, I'm sorry to see you out there. Goodbye, George. And thank you for trying to help.
Dear Hendrickson, all I'm saying is that because I may have become a little more successful than some of my fellow laborers, there's no reason for me now to put my heel upon their necks.
Judge Altgeld, it's a good thing you didn't talk like that during the campaign. I had no idea you had so much sympathy for the working man. It's not your style.
Well, I wasn't always a bourbon. I came to Chicago with $100 in my pocket. I made my own way.
I know. Well, I've got to go, Judge. I want to thank you again for the financial help and your campaign speeches in the German sections. You spout sauerkraut just like a native. Your father was a Dutchman, wasn't he?
I was born in Germany. My family came over when I was 3 months old. I thought everybody in the party knew my life history when I was spouting sauerkraut, as you put it, during the 84 campaign.
Oh, don't take offense, Judge. Just my way of talking.
Ah, George, I was worried about you. You know Mr. Hendrickson of the Democratic State Committee? George Schilling.
Yes, your labor friend. DeGates, Mr. Schilling. Well, I was just leaving. Incidentally, Judge, I know you have your eye on the Senate. It's an easier hop from the governor's office, you know.
Is it?
Well, it's a thought. You have a lot of years. Good night.
Good night. Well, you look sick. Ich will grün Äpfeln hast du gegessen.
I'm tired, Judge. I'm tired, and I don't know where to turn, and the minutes are ticking away. I went to see the anarchists in the prison. Those men should not hang.
George, it's all played out. You did what you could. Can I get you something?
Murder, Judge! Believe me, even they don't know who threw that bomb. This is called justice.
Don't work yourself up. Now, that trial is dead and gone. It's over. I'll be glad when the whole mess is over. And if nothing else, these men have a long history of preaching hate for the law and violence.
They weren't tried for preaching. They were tried for murder.
And what about the violence of the police and the strike breakers and the private armies of Pinkertons clubbing workmen all over Chicago for the last 10 years. Did anyone try them? Did anyone try the police for killing two men at McCormick's on May 3rd before that meeting, huh?
I'm sorry. It's burning in me. Peter, I'm not a violent man. I fought the revolutionaries. I warned them they were only going to cause bloodshed. Believe me, I know them. They are blustering, loud-mouthed fools, but murderers, no. You've got to do something. You have important friends. Have someone call the governor. Even now, you can save them.
What could I possibly do? You had all the power you could get down there at Springfield with you yesterday, battering their heads against that wall of hate. At least you'd save two of them.
Why didn't you help, Peter? I never asked, but why? You never spoke out. On everything else, yes, but not this. Why?
Because it was futile. Because the anarchists are an anathema. Because I was a nobody. And because this is not my fight.
Oh, don't rationalize a betrayal of justice, Judge. That's everyone's fight.
Were you afraid?
Oh, let's drop this whole thing. I am sick to death of anarchists and plots and bombs. It'll all be finished at noon tomorrow, and we can go on to other things.
Altgeld, the American dream, the piper of principle, defender of the underdog. Have you conquered Chicago, or has it conquered you?
That is a stupid remark. You come here to cry on my shoulder, and you end up by accusing me of betraying somebody or something. Betraying what? Betraying whom?
I'm sorry. I'm so involved. I expect everyone to understand what's at stake. I shouldn't have come here tonight.
Oh, no, Schilling, Schilling, Schilling. Entschuldige the bitte. Es tut mir leid. Sit, sit, sit. No, I've been irritable. I apologize. You're not entirely wrong. I know what you're feeling. I know what's going on here, and I have some ideas myself. They're not so different than yours. But in order to make them work, I have to have power, real power. And when I have it, when I get my hands on the lever that moves things, I'll give it a shove.
Where do you want to go, Peter? What do you want?
I don't know. In all honesty, I don't know.
Her promise true. Give me her promise true. That ne'er forgot will be. And for Bonnie Annie Laurie, I'd lay me down and die.
The ticket seller, Brand Whitlock, the drum beater, Altgeld, the lion tamer. Together, we can entertain Illinois for the next three, well, two generations.
Oh, or as long as Illinois entertains us.
What are you doing here among the old folks?
Good evening, Governor.
He's a fine reporter. Writes excellent Altgeld stories for the Herald.
Governor, wie viele grüne Äpfel hast du gegessen? You don't look well. You need a vacation very badly.
It's my first day in office. Everybody's trying to get me to take a vacation.
How's the party outside, Governor?
Well, it's going so well, we'll have to bring the Columbian Exposition down here to Springfield. Chicago will be too dull.
Last time I peeked in there, I saw two bankers, two socialists, and a single taxer guzzling beer with Potter Palmer and a skinny lecturer for the WCTU. Hinky Dink McKenna and Bathhouse John Coughlin were drumming up marks for a crap game.
Well, I better put a stop to that.
No, no, let him eat, Governor. The Democrats have been out of here for 30 years, and they're lean and hungry.
Let me have men about me that are fat. I'll be right back.
That man shook more hands, kissed more babies, admired more dairies, and helped set more hens than any other man that ever ran for governor.
Hendrickson, how are you going to make good in an administration that got voted in by the wildest coalition of Lutherans, Catholics, atheists, socialists, bankers, railroad lawyers, businessmen, and laborers this country ever saw?
I don't care what they pray to, long as they vote Democratic.
It sure spreads you thin, though, having to bait for every fish in the ocean.
I'd say there are going to be some changes in Illinois.
Like getting rid of all the Republicans holding onto desks and replacing them with Democrats, true and blue.
Well, Altgeld could be a great governor. And in this state, you kiss and make up with men who last April you called thieves, fools, and ballot box stuffers. Well, that's politics, and the governor's a great politician.
Oh, he has a lot more to be proud of.
He's the most important thinker on labor issues, judicial procedure, penology, and social reform in the state, if not the country.
So the circus is still on, eh? Well, as chief lion tamer, I am going to open cage number one. Now here, you want you to take this down for your paper, will you, Brand? There you go. Now first, I have this day appointed George Schilling, leader of Altgeld's Labor Legion, Secretary of State Bureau of Labor Statistics.
Well, congratulations.
Thank you.
Now, secondly, there is a man of whom I have grown very fond during the campaign. He is both young and artistic, and he is the best reporter in Chicago. Brandt, I need your company down here. Will you come and work in the State Department? Now under William Buck Hendrickson.
Thank you, thank you.
Hear, hear. Well, I'd be honored, sir. But I have one condition, that I be allowed to study law while I'm down here.
Condition is granted. You to have a cigar. Well, now, isn't politics wonderful? Huh? Sure, some people get their recreation from playing poker and betting on the horses. I get mine from politics. All right, here's a toast. To ambition. That lively goddess who teaches us the virtues of hard work, aggressive action, and perseverance.
And to her husband. Principle.
Without whom she would succumb to the devil. George, you'll be pleased to know that our child labor law has been passed. Won't you stay for lunch? We'll celebrate. Grant Whitlock's coming over. We'll open a bottle of wine of rare vintage.
I'll stay if we have beer. A labor leader does not accept luxuries from a representative of the upper classes.
Now, whatever is on your mind, you better let it out, huh?
Are you going to stay on that ladder? Peter, for 6 years, we've been talking about the men convicted of the Haymarket riot. 5 of them are dead now. 4 were hanged and 1 committed suicide. You can't bring the dead ones back. But Field and Schwab and Niebe are still in prison. Are you going to pardon them or not?
I can't answer that now.
Uh-huh. Every one of your friends waiting, saying he'll do it tomorrow. But 3 months have passed, Peter, and tomorrow hasn't come. Do you know how many people have signed the new petition?
Well, I never signed a petition. I have taken no position on those men.
You just might end up as the only public figure with no position on those men. You made a lot of promises.
Now, keep a level head. I made no promises. I said that I would look into the matter. It is by no means the only issue that demands my attention.
You had plenty of time for a nice long vacation. Plenty of time to sit around with your new political cronies handing out jobs to what some of my friends call a bunch of dumb cops. Right now, you have a duty to perform a simple, humane act, but you won't. Well, maybe we've been laboring under a misapprehension about peerless Peter.
Schilling, don't you ever lecture me about duty. I keep my own conscience. Don't try to replace it with yours. Now, we have been friends for some time. I'd like to keep that friendship. Now, right now, I have no opinion about a pardon. I haven't had a chance to look into the record. But when I do, I will act. Not out of emotion, but on a basis of facts.
There's no reason for a pardon to upset anyone. Everyone supports the amnesty movement. We've got bankers, the Bar Association, labor unions, most of the Cook County bench.
George, if you believe that everyone supports a pardon for these anarchist traitors, you are a bigger ninny than I thought. There is a secret organization that has spent close to $500,000 to combat, quote, anarchistic, socialistic, atheistic ideas.
Here. What is this?
All the trial records of the Haymarket affair. They have been here since late January. Now, if these men are innocent, you'll see. If they are guilty, they can rot in jail 100 years before I'll lift a finger.
It is the verdict of the coroner's jury that patrolman Matthias J. Deegan came to his death from a bomb, thrown by a person or persons unknown, but acting in conspiracy with August Spees, Albert Parsons, Samuel Fielden.
I believe what I read in the newspapers. I believe the parties are guilty.
Challenge for cause.
Overruled.
Well, Judge, I'm certainly prejudiced against any communist.
Challenge for cause.
Overruled, Mr. Black.
Gentlemen of the jury, the conspiracy we will show here was so large, the numbers so appalling, it seems impossible to describe it. It was a conspiracy aimed at nothing less than the destruction of Chicago and the American government. Bombs were to be thrown in all parts of our city, at police stations, at patrol wagons. They expected a row down at Haymarket Square. There was going to be one bomb thrown at least down there. And perhaps more. That would bring out the police. These men cried out for hate and violence. For hate and violence. For hate and violence. For hate and violence.
I ask you to consider that no matter what the defendants advised about dynamite or armed resistance, if none of them advised the throwing of that bomb at Haymarket, they cannot be held for the actions of others. Now it may occur to some of you gentlemen to ask, what can these men preach the use of dynamite? May they urge people to go out and overthrow the government without punishment? Is there no law to punish them if they do this thing? There is, gentlemen. But it is not, and never has been, murder. It is a different law, and nothing the prosecution does to jump the chasm between them can be successful unless it is done out of hatred, malice, or prejudice. Hatred, malice, or prejudice.
Gentlemen, we do not have the bomb thrower here. We have the accessories, the conspirators, the individuals who framed the plan, who encouraged it. And if we never knew who did it, still the defendants are guilty. And if you now have prejudice against the defendants, you have a right to it. Prejudice. Men, organized assassins, can preach murder in our own city for years. You hear the proof, and you say you have no prejudice? Don't shirk the issues. Law is on trial here. Anarchy is on trial!
And according to the verdict, the
sentence of this court is that the defendant Nevey be imprisoned in the state penitentiary at Joliet at hard labor for 15 years, and that each of the other defendants be hanged by the neck until dead. Be hanged by the neck until dead.
The evidence was a web of insinuations, bias, and pure baloney. According to Gary's law, the anarchists would still be guilty if a policeman had thrown the bomb. So the question is, what can we do?
Well, there's an open letter from the Trade and Labor Assembly, which you will have tomorrow. The Amnesty Association has a new petition with over 60,000 signatures. It can...
No, I am not interested in mercy petitions. These men were innocent. I have to prove that. I'll need some more facts. Something to back me up. Affidavits, sworn statements about false arrests, threats, you know, about this special bailiff packing the jury, about perjured testimony at the tribe, bribes, beating, the role of the policemen and the Pinkertons in the strike. Real evidence. Schilling, can you get me something like that?
I'll leave for Chicago tonight.
Now, you have to be very quiet about this. Done absolutely quietly, because it could blow up in my face.
There's a train at 9:15. I can still catch it. Altgeld, lieber Freund. I'll let you know when I have everything.
Yes.
Good night, friend. Governor, the politicians will squeal like stuck pigs. The public, too. Even after 6 years, there's still heated feeling the anarchists had it coming to them, one way or the other.
Friend, have a cigar. The construction bill and the franchise bill are dead in this session. No more business as usual.
They'll pass them over your veto.
I tried this morning, they failed.
How? I happen to know that there is at least $100 a head for every man in the legislature. And Blaine and Forrester were in for $2,000.
I got Burke to tell Volk about Blaine's $2,000. It made him look like a sucker for taking less. He was furious. He took care of the others. Now, it's up to you to pacify Blaine. I'm going to need his help.
You really mean to remake the system, don't you? You're making a lot of enemies, Governor, with all this reform business.
Including you?
No. You got us in. You're the boss. I just don't want to see you kill your own future. And the party. Integrity is fine if it's not a hair shirt or a pair of lead shoes. It's still a long walk to Washington. Well, I'll see what I can do with Blaine, and you do something for me. Forget the anarchists.
Is that a command?
Listen, McCabe was around the Jackson clubhouse last week making kind of weasel remarks about you. I actually had to punch him in the mouth. You know that reporter, McCabe, don't you?
The Chicago Tribune.
Yeah, he's a snide little wise guy. Among other things, he called you a liar and an alien. Not only by birth, but by temperament and sympathy.
And for that, you punched him in the mouth?
He called me a few things, too. But never mind that. What I'm saying is, they're expecting it. They're hoping for it. They're looking for it like a pack of hyenas. Because Joe Medill and the powers hate your guts. If you touch this, you're going to be knocked right into a dung heap. And as far as the party is concerned, you're going to drag them right along with you. Governor, I'd say this. You want to do right by labor. It's okay. You want to reform the courts? You want to remodel the prisons? You want to hand out food to the starving mass? That's all right. You want to be a reform governor? You want to become a senator? You want to change a lot of things you think need changing? That's all right, too. But this thing is tainted. It'll kill you. It'll kill you in politics. It'll kill you financially. And it'll kill your friends to see you broken and lying in the mud. That's all I have to say.
I apologize to the governor for my bluntness.
If Brian Whitlock is outside, send him in, please.
I see you told Henderson about the franchise bill. Yeah. It's all over the offices. You're causing a lot of long faces.
Politics, the old skin game.
Well, you've got people confused, playing with their dice and under their rules and keeping one hand on the Bible. They don't believe it.
Well, do you?
It is unusual. A man either compromises to stay on top or clutches principles and falls, waiting for history to redeem him. That takes a lot of faith. There's a feature article in the Century magazine. Chicago Anarchists of 1886. Crime, the Trial, and the Punishment, by the judge who presided at the trial, Joseph Eaton Gary.
Did you read it?
Yes.
Well?
Well, Governor, he justifies everything. The verdict, the sentence, everything.
We've got a crisis. The quarry workers are on strike. Up at Lamont, near the drainage canal. Thousands of them. There's been some shooting. Several dead and some wounded.
Doesn't say who did the shooting.
Well, it doesn't matter right now, does it? Contractors want the state militia.
No, I am not sending troops unless the local sheriffs are completely unable to handle things. There were two men killed in another Lamont strike there 8 years ago by the state militia. Buck, I want you to do me a favor. Will you telegraph the sheriffs of Will, DuPage, and Cook counties under your signature? Tell them to move in with the deputies and to keep the peace and nothing more. Now, Brian, will you call Lieutenant Baker at the barracks? Tell him to report here to my office. I suppose after all these years as mayor of Chicago, these labor troubles are old hat to you.
You certainly handled it well, Governor.
Thank you.
Even the Tribune agreed that the sheriffs were at fault.
You know that lackey in Will County had only 22 deputies when I got there to cover a 14-mile trouble area? He told me he had 120.
The important thing is that you showed everyone you'd use the militia when it's necessary.
Buck, let me tell you something. Labor is going to push. It has to. And we're apt to have a lot more trouble. But I will not tolerate violence. I will use the militia impartially to quell riots and to uphold the law.
Governor, if I may be permitted to change the subject, I came to Springfield on party business. What you did at Lamont came at a critical time. Do you want the Senate seat?
Yes.
What about the anarchists?
The subjects linked?
Yes, they definitely are.
It's merely a matter of justice there, Carter.
No, not this. You're a smart man, Governor, and a powerful one. In all honesty, I believe you could be President of the United States.
If it... Born in Germany, have you forgotten that?
Have you? Buck, I'd like to talk to the Governor privately for a minute.
Yes.
Are you determined to go ahead with it? You'll get no backing from the party. None. That's official. Personally, well, I testified at the anarchist trial. You know that. I think you might get away with a simple clemency pardon, sugar-coated with high morality and charity. But my information tells me you've been out gathering evidence. That can only mean you're not thinking of clemency, but of an absolute pardon.
But if the facts prove that they're innocent, am I just going to give them a clemency pardon and leave the stigma of being criminals on them? Did you read Judge Gary's article?
Yes. It's unfortunate that it was published now. The whole trial is out in the open again.
Unfortunate? He's defending himself in advance against what I may do. And what a defense. He sets out to prove that these anarchists were condemned because of their horrible deeds, not their belief. And then he goes on to try to demonstrate this theory by a batch of quotations from their most incendiary articles and speeches. Now, you listen to this. This is Gary's Law. The conviction has not gone on the ground that they did have actually any personal participation, but that they advised large classes to commit murder and left it to any individual who listened to that advice. He says the case is without precedent. Well, the fool says it himself.
Governor, I don't want to interfere, but to invoke a tempest with an absolute pardon, when with a quiet wave of your hand you could accomplish virtually the same thing, seems to me fanatical.
Everything you wanted, Peter, and more. Affidavits from witnesses who were threatened, clubbed, and offered bribes. There's a deposition about the killing at McCormick's. Judge McAllister's opinion on the beatings at Turner Hall. I got the last of it this morning.
Good. I want to thank you. Thank you for coming down here now. I'm going to be facing tremendous opposition. I'm going to need all the support that I can get. Not only from labor, you understand, but from individuals who have no axe to grind. Now, I want you to go back to Chicago tonight, as soon as it can be arranged, and I want you to see Senator Lyman Trumbull. Do you know him?
Well, I've met him. He was one of the prime movers behind the amnesty petition, and I know he has always felt that this was not a fair trial.
Good. Now, I want you to tell him, say that the governor would consider it an honor and a favor if he would come to the Capitol, see me, and personally request me to pardon these men. Now, I want you to make the same request of Judge Rogers and Lyman Gage, Stephen Gregory, and four or five others from the Cook County bench. You know the ones that you could see.
Yes, Governor.
No. Trumbull won't do it.
What happened?
He's an old man. I didn't realize he's over 80. He listened to what I had to say, what you asked me to say. Then he said, I'm sorry, I can't do that. We talked for a while about the case. Then he said, there's no question about it. They didn't have a fair trial. So I asked him again. And he said, no. To press him any further would have been disrespectful.
Any reasons?
No. None. As for the others, the answer was the same. They won't do it.
Governor, if you go ahead with this, you'll have to do it alone.
The crowd on one side and John Peter on the other. That's the way it was when I was a little Dutch farm boy back in school.
You don't have to fight them all. I know you've been thinking about an absolute pardon, but you can't call clemency a compromise.
You left this little book in with the affidavits, The Life of Albert Parsons.
His wife still sells it on the street corners. The night before the hanging, he gave me a letter for his children. It's in there. I thought it might interest you.
Anarchy, a stupid, pernicious doctrine. And still he was willing to die for it.
He did not die for anarchy. He died because he wouldn't ask for mercy. He was a fanatic. Good is he doing anybody now? It's better to live than fight.
Now, quiet down, my friend. Quiet down and read me Parson's letter.
To my darling, precious children, as I write this word, I blot your names with a tear. We never meet again. Oh, my children, how deeply, dearly your papa loves you. We show our love by living for our loved ones. We also prove our love by dying, when necessary, for them. Of my life, from the cause of my unnatural and cruel death, you will learn from others. Your father is a self-offered sacrifice upon the altar of liberty and happiness. To you, I leave the legacy of an honest name and duty done. Preserve it. Emulate it. Be true to yourselves. You cannot then be false to others. Your mother is the grandest, noblest of women. Love and honor her. Bless you, my precious ones. Farewell.
You know something, George? There's a time in life when you find yourself doing something or not doing something, and suddenly your whole character is exposed. And you look at it, whatever it is, and you know that that is what you always were and are and always will be.
Morning, Governor. Someone at my desk said you wanted to see me.
Brand, I want you to go down to your office and get the proper parchments and make out 3 pardons. For Samuel Fielden, Michael Schwab, and Oscar Niebe.
Yes, sir.
I want you to make them out yourself. Get the signature of the Secretary of State. Bring them back to me at 11 a.m.
Yes, sir.
Hey, Mr. Dreyer is outside, waiting to take these to the prison at Joliet today. I want you to distribute these proofs to the press. Now, if they want me, I'll see them at 1 o'clock.
Right.
Thank you. Hello, Governor. Brand told me.
George.
Another pardon message?
Proofs are in there. But don't try to read it now. Somewhere, you better sit down.
Peter, you've done a complete legal brief. You knew all that time which direction you were heading, didn't you?
No, I couldn't be sure until I was completed. If all the efforts that I have made which produce nothing were collected and piled on top of me, they would bury me so deep that even Gabriel's horn couldn't awaken.
You know, exposing the errors of the courts will be shocking to the public, even if nothing but the truth is told.
George, this is no game. This is law and order. The law is at stake, and order is civilization. If men can be murdered by the state for expressing their opinions, whatever they may be, and the courts can be used like a bludgeon, then there is no law or order or civilization or justice. And the anarchists were right. Somebody has to prove that they were wrong.
Governor, is it true that your pardon message does, in fact, attack the entire system of justice in this state?
Did you read the message, Mr. McCabe?
I haven't had time yet, Governor. I glanced through it.
I see. Well, it attacks the trial of the state of Illinois versus the Chicago anarchists.
This is not a mercy pardon?
I do not believe in the executive interference of the fair administration of justice. If the defendants were guilty as charged, then no punishment is too severe.
You say they're not guilty, Governor? Contrary to the finding of the trial court and the Illinois Supreme Court? Is that right?
This is a full and absolute pardon.
You were petitioned for clemency, Governor. What are your reasons for going further?
Well, there have been other petitioners familiar with the record, who go a good deal farther than I do. They claim that that jury was packed, that the incompetent jurors made the trial illegal, that the defendants were never proven guilty of the crime charged in the indictment, that the state attorney himself said that there was no case against the defendants, and that the trial judge was either so prejudiced or so anxious to please certain elements in the community that he could not and he did not grant a fair trial.
You agree with those other petitioners?
The record sustains their allegations.
Is it true that you despised Judge Gary?
Well, any judge may unintentionally and unconsciously be
become merely the expression of that which is, for the time, the dominant influence of the land. Now, it takes great strength of character to rise above that. I denounce, therefore, not Gary the man, but Garyism.
How do you think the public will accept your action, Governor?
I think it will subject me to a great deal of scorn.
Governor, do you have any associations with anarchists, which might lead some people to believe that you're devoted to their cause?
Mr. McCabe, you know what anarchy stands for. I have been serving the law all of my life. First as a lawyer, then as a judge, and now as a governor. And I hope to go on serving it. Now, that is hardly the career of an anarchist. Feel as if I could embrace the world or push over the pyramids if I wanted to. Let the public attack. They couldn't cut through my hide with an axe.
Garbage together like this, it's kind of frightening, isn't it? It wouldn't have been so vicious if the governor hadn't attacked Judge Gary that way.
Altgeld, a viper. Slimy demagogue. Anarchist. The New York Times called him an alien, a foreigner. He looks on America as a place to make money, not as a place to make a home. Washington, Pittsburgh, New Orleans, Boston, Los Angeles. They're making it into a national scandal. Look.
I never saw this one. Poetry from the New York Sun.
Oh, wild Chicago, when the time is ripe for ruin's deeds, when constitutions, courts, and laws go down midst crashing creeds, lift up your weak and guilty hands from out of the wreck of states, and as the crumbling towers fall down, write Altgeld on your gates.
Peter. Good day, Governor.
The 4th of July is the day after tomorrow. I'm going to gather up all this junk and build a fire.
Burned in effigy, excluded from state ceremonies, even denied the customary privilege of making a farewell address at his successor's inauguration, Altgeld nevertheless went on fighting injustice, greed, and corruption until his death, 9 years later. Denied his ambition to reach the Senate, John Peter Altgeld became, in the title of Vachel Lindsay's famous poem about him, the eagle that is forgotten.
These stories of past courage can teach, they can offer hope, and they can provide inspiration. But they cannot supply courage itself. For this, each man must look into his own soul.